Welcome to another episode of Ask a Photo Pro with your friendly neighborhood photographer. It is me. I'm Carty. I'm here for another day. We are talking about natural light portraits today. Great light is essential for photography. It's the difference between an average photograph and an extraordinary one. Light is the most important fundamental elements of photography, and it has a significant impact on the mood, emotion, and obviously the overall quality of our images. I am so into this vibe today. Great light can create a sense of depth, dimension, and texture in a photograph. It can reveal shapes, forms, contours of our subjects. It can also add depth and dimension to the image. It also creates shadows and highlights that add texture to the scene, making it visually appealing and interesting for the viewer. Great light can evoke emotion and mood in a photograph. Different types of light can create different moods and emotions, such as warm and cozy, cold and lonely, dramatic and intense. For example, golden hour. That light creates a warm, romantic mood, while harsh, direct sunlight can create a sense of tension or drama. Great light can help tell a story in a photograph, and it can highlight certain areas or elements of a scene. It can draw your eye to important details of a photograph, and it can create a narrative. Great light. A photograph of a person walking down a dimly lit alley can create a sense of danger or suspense, while a child photographed playing in soft, warm light can create a sense of innocence and wonder. Great light can help capture the true essence of a subject. It can reveal that character, the personality, and the uniqueness of a subject, making your subject stand out from the crowd. It can also enhance colors, textures, and patterns of a subject, bringing your subject to life and making them more compelling. Great light is essential in photography because it can make a photograph more visually appealing, more emotionally engaging, and narratively rich and true to life. By understanding the importance of light and using light effectively, us as photographers, that's how we take photography to the next level. And today, in this week's inspiration, I'm going to be talking about natural light and natural light for people. We're going to start by looking at my favorite photographer of all time, Helmut Newton. And one thing that I don't think enough people realize is how often Helmut Newton used natural light in this photograph. This photograph here of David Lynch and Isabella Rossellini is an incredibly natural light photograph. David Bowie, natural light photograph. Some of Helmut Newton's most provocative work was shot without any technology beyond the sun. Sigourney Weaver, direct sun. Look at that light. He was unbelievable with natural light, and he used it multiple ways. He used front light, he used side light, he used backlight, and he used it so well. Existing light was another thing that Helmut did and used so absolutely well. Look at this photograph of Grace Jones. And as an example of natural light and how he used the position of the sun, he is and will always be my favorite shooter. Look at his use of natural light here. So Helmut Newton, one of the masters who has inspired me to go above and beyond with my light and the things that I try with natural light more than anyone else. Now, you heard me say front light, side light, and back light. There's many different ways to see light, but as far as the position of the light, when we're photographing, the light's going to exist behind us, which is front light for what we're shooting. It's going to be coming from one side or the other, or it's going to be where we're aiming. We're going to be aiming into the sun, which is backlight. How that applies to us photographing people is incredible. And I've selected a project here from Behance that this photographer, his name is Glenn Thompson, did this incredible editorial using natural light, and he's using direct sun. And I want you to see just, first of all, direct sun and how he poses the model in order to get just an incredibly natural feeling. Do let me know in comments if you guys are feeling this direct light, natural light photography. Like, I was so inspired by seeing this. So inspired. And again, this isn't a master photographer. This is a contemporary photographer like you and I. But look at how in this one editorial, he's aiming into the sun. He's using top down light. He's using different angles and perspectives. And he's also, excuse me, he's also in the water with the model. Look at this. It's just so raw and easy, but so beautiful and captivating. Do let me know if you like how much these photographs are speaking to me. They're definitely speaking to me. I hope they're speaking to you as well. I want you guys to be confident with natural light. I want you to push harder than maybe you might think. Also, look at how this photographer is using fabric in order to diffuse the natural light that's hitting his model. It's so clever. So clever. It's just free. And if you look at other projects from Glenn, this is a Canadian photographer, by the way. If you look at other projects by this photographer, you can see his style come out. You could look at this beautiful Rembrandt lighting that he's doing with natural light. It's just placement. And this photographer, he just really does it well. He makes simple photographs. And again, the level that this photographer is, I have no idea how known or unknown this photographer is, but his natural light portraits and the way that he approaches his subjects and shoots his subjects, it's just raw and honest, and I like it. It's candid. It has a really nice feeling. Giving you some examples of natural light indoors. Venetian blinds give the most amazing light, and I've played with them a few times, but this is just another story. And look at how simple his photographs are. They're just simple, but tell me he doesn't see light. Oh, you're very welcome, Casper. And tell me he doesn't see photography. It's just interesting. His use of a mirror here, you notice he put a mirror on the floor to kick back light. It just looks really interesting. A mirror here to give just a little bit more interest over here and likely cover this hard edge. That is the wall right there. Look at the light that's on her face. Look at this beautiful highlight that's on her cheek. Look at where the light's coming from. And he's shooting into the shadow side and metering the shadow side. So the meter reading is taken right there. It's just gorgeous. gorgeous. Again, a great use of the mirror. Look at that. A great use of the mirror. Are you guys inspired yet? Are you guys inspired? This is no lights. It's a photographer in a 50 millimeter. I hope you guys are inspired. That Venetian blinds story, I don't know if I still have that story on my website. Do I? I'm not sure, Carty, if I do. But we're going to try to see if I have it, because it's, yeah, I do. It's such a great example of my use of Venetians. This is old work. This is from like probably 2005. But again, the Venetians, man, I love this shit. I love this. And just windows. You know, this is my version of that like natural light at home kind of vibe. You know? Yeah, some old work. Okay, so let me show you another example or three from Behance, because I did bookmark. Oh yeah, that's the wrong link. It's this one that I need. Yes, this one that I need. I'm trying to manage my windows here and not have too many open, because that sometimes means a little bit of laggy. More natural light inspiration. This photographer, Bogdan Moldovan. More natural light inspiration. Look at this window light. Look at this beautiful streaky window light. His exposure is here. Beautiful highlight on her hair. Look at this little highlight down her body. Her pants are transparent, so you can see her legs through the pants. This is fire. Honestly, fire. I hope you're feeling it. Look at this highlight on the door frame. This haze is just everything. I love, love, love this. Again, look at this use of natural light. You're so great, Gregory. High quality content. You're, well, there you go. You're very, very welcome. Look at this. Yes or yes? The whole goal is to inspire you guys and blow your brains. Look at this natural light photo. Aiming into the window, aiming in here, metering here. All this goes super hot. The shirt blows out a bit, but the highlights are just everything. This camera is not holding the highlights very well. It really is burning out here. But my R5 would hold this better. Exposure on her face is amazing. This is epic. Epic, epic, epic. Again, I hope I'm inspiring you guys to just do you hate her pose. That's all right. You would shoot it differently. The thing that I'm hoping for, I'm hoping I'm inspiring you guys today to just try natural light differently. Try some reflections, try some mirrors, try some Venetians, try open shade. I just want you guys to try some shit. This should be inspiring though. And I love shooting through fabrics, and you see he's shooting through this fabric. He's got this glass here. He's got glass here. It's just super dynamic, and this sort of her looking off and not paying attention to camera makes it feel voyeuristic. This is really winning. I like this a lot. Great, great body language, eh? Look at the body language, like the extra arch, the arm. Really, really, really great. I would make sure that this highlight that's coming this direction doesn't touch her nose here. But where it's hitting here is everything. This is really strong. Let me know if you like the photos that I've selected today to share with y'all. Bogdan Moldovan. I think I'm going to share one more with you. Let me know if you like this content that I'm sharing with you today. I think I'm going to share uno mas. One more amazing natural light session that I can share. Where is that? Open shade. So funny. It's the same photographer. No, it isn't. Andres Sandoval Vidal. Look at this photography. This is open shade. And shade is an amazing trick. This is another example that I'm glad that I found. Shade is an amazing trick for perfect light with photography. The thing that's amazing with shade is look at the shadows. The shadows are so nuanced and slight. Look at how the gradient between where the light is hitting and the shadow, like how that transition fades. It's so gradual. When you're using raw light in the studio or undiffused light, or if it's a sunny day with like pure sun, your shadows become very hard. And like literally hard everywhere on the face where the light isn't hitting is like very hard shadow. So I adopted shooting in open shade years ago. I'm looking for more unique light than just perfect open shade, but it is a great way to kill it with your light. Look at this model's abs. Insane. Look at her belly. The light on her face, this is obviously direct light. You can see what I meant with the harsh shadows, but also how this background just goes black. There's also the sun that's hitting back here. This is amazing for natural light photography. Like, I really think that this is a great example. And compared to the open shade photo, this model in the sun, it almost looks like a different person. And then this is dappling. You can see how the sun is partially coming through and you're getting different like highlights of the sun coming through the clouds. You can see it's happening over here. Let me hide my camera. And over here, this is called dappling. Dappling. When the sun pushes through like this, through trees. So it's also very interesting to find cool dappling because it looks amazing on film. More direct sun. This one's not my favorite one, but it's a good example of direct. All right. Next, what are we talking about? Notes. So some of my favorite natural light portraits, I shared a couple, but I'm going to share a couple of my own personal favorite natural light portraits and just a little bit about the approach. Starting with this. This is a natural light photo. This is window light. And if you look at Yasmin's eyes, you can see me in her eyes standing in front of a bay of windows, which you see right here in her eyes. A huge bay of windows. So this is a natural light photo. And again, look at the nuance of where she's lit and where it transitions into shadow and how gradual that is. Look at the butterfly lighting. I'm doing this butterfly lighting, which is giving this darkness here. You can see the nose shadow here, but this is butterfly lighting done with natural light, which is again incredibly natural light. So crazy butterfly lighting, really slight shadow under the nose, very gradual transition between where she's lit and where she's not lit, and down here where she's not lit versus here where she's lit. the transition between here and here is very, very, very slight. So, one favorite natural light photo. Let me find another. And this is different. This is lit with direct sun. The sun is behind me. That's why we have a nice deep blue sky. Sun is behind me. You can see the shadow is going underneath the shoe. The swoosh is pushing a little shadow down here. The pants, good fabric. This is like one of those natural light pictures that it worked in this situation. I wouldn't have shot his face under this light, but with this, worked perfect. Again, let me show you. I have a couple that really demonstrate dappling. This is a great example of open shade. You can see just the light on her face and how flattering it is when it's open shade. It's just super, super easy. Super easy. More natural light photos. Yasmin, natural light photo. Again, I love photographing her. Her face is so great for light, but natural light, open shade. You can look at her eyes and you can see that we're outside. You can see me there holding my camera. We're outside. You can see it right here. That tells you everything. You have to always look at the catch lights in the eyes. That's why I always ask you guys to give me big files. I think it's important to really, really look at your photos. Another natural light. And just different ways that I use natural light. This is a great example of aiming into the sun. You can see, obviously, our sun source here, and I'm aiming into the sun. My exposure is in here on them. We have that great highlight on these guys. Great long shadows, and just like this overall haze. But because I'm aiming into the sun, you can see the sky is white. The sky only is blue when the sun's behind you. Anytime you're aiming into the sun is going to be white like this. So do keep that in mind. If you're wondering why you're getting those cool sun flares, but you're not getting a blue sky, it's because you're aiming at the sun. All right. I think I have one or two more natural light photos to show you. This is a great open shade, another example with a guy. It just looks like the light is coming from everywhere and nowhere at the same time. It's just super easy, super flattering. You can see I put him underneath an overhang, so the top down light isn't affecting him because, again, you can see his eyes are a bit squinty. You can shoot overcast natural light, but if the sun is too high, like if it's noon, even on an overcast day, it'll still produce raccoon eyes. So he actually has a little bit of grooves that are just natural here, but the more top down the light is, the more this gets darker and the more it's accentuated. So you have to be super conscious, even if it's overcast, where the direction of the light's coming from. That is one more. Oh yes, one more. And then this is our thumbnail for today, and I think a great example of natural light. You can see there's just a little bit of dappling, like the sun is coming through here, but it's not hitting her face. This is a V-flat. So this is a V-flat outside. You can take V-flats outside and position V-flats in perfect light, and then you have a perfect background outside in the light that you want. So I bring V-flats outside at times, and it's funny, I showed Corey that, and Corey is the king of the V-flats outside. So this, again, natural light photo, open shade, and look at this girl's skin. Look at her skin. Look at how beautiful the transitions are. Look at her eyes, how her eyes just absolutely pop. And it's natural light, but it's like shadowless light. So again, just tricks of the trade for shooting natural light outside. If you want to be safe, don't shoot where the sun is, shoot where the sun isn't. It's a great tip for shooting portraits outside. I think I taught Julie how to shoot where the sun isn't 3 years ago when she first started watching my show. I met Julie before I even started doing this show. So early on, I was telling her to look for shade. And she's now, through the 3 years that she's been shooting, really develop her natural light photography and her shade photography into something that's really unique. Like, she knows what she's looking for. So that's really important and really critical when we're making natural light portraits. It's all about finding inspired light. It can't just be simple. And in our next section, which I like to call mastery, I'm just going to give you some practical tips for how to find magic natural light. Like, there's a couple of things that we can do. There's more than a couple of things that we can do. We're always looking for the unique. And I think how you go and you find the unique is you have to go outside during times that you wouldn't normally be outside. If you're not a morning person, wake up and literally go outside at sunrise and make photos. And by the way, there's nobody around at sunrise. So an area that might be super busy is going to be completely empty at sunrise. So keys for amazing natural light. And obviously we're talking about portraits, so you need to have a subject. You need to have a subject to practice on. Yeah. So in order to get amazing natural light portraits, couple things we got to do. First is we have to seek. And I think the best way to seek is by seeing new things. And I like to go out during a time that I know the light is going to be perfect. I'm not necessarily great in the morning because I do so much stuff up until like 4 a.m. So I go out in the last 2 hours of sun. In the last 2 hours of sun. Now, if I'm shooting street portraits, that's definitely what I would do. That's definitely what I do when I go out in street portraits, because what's happening in the last 2 hours is we have long shadows and also amazing sun flare. And we have amazing sun flare. So if you aim towards the sun, it's going to look amazing because the sun's low enough. It's going to give you beautiful flares. And if the sun's behind you, everything that you aim at has perfect light. Every subject that you aim at has perfect light. And if you're using side light, or if the sun's coming from the left or from the right, you're getting amazing shadows. So those are like three tips for going out if you're trying to do street portraits, or if you're going out with a subject and you're trying to do a mini shoot or a model test. So last 2 hours is magic. Now, sometimes you can't go out in the last 2 hours of light. That's when you have to shoot in like non-optimal conditions. We'll call it imperfect. Oh, this pen, how I love thee. Imperfect conditions. So when you're going out in imperfect conditions, and what are imperfect conditions? any time that's close to 12 noon. So we'll call it 11 a.m. And this doesn't matter where you are. The sun behaves the same way. Doesn't matter where you are. I would say 11 a.m. until, like, it, depending on when the sun goes down, like, call it until, like, the last 4 hours of sun. So 11 to 2, we'll call it. That's, like, the worst time to be outside shooting portraits because the sun is high. The sun obviously moves across the sky in an arc, and there's a time when the sun is super top heavy, and it's usually between 11 and 1 p.m. At noon, the sun is literally supposed to be aiming straight down, which gives us raccoon eyes, and it's really bright and harsh for our subjects. Now, if it's a cloudy day, meaning it's between 11 and 2 p.m. and it's a cloudy day and the sun is behind the cloud, still at between 11 and 2, it's still coming downwards. Even if it's diffused, it's still top light, so you will still get raccoon eyes. It's just diffused raccoon eyes. So 11 to 2 p.m., if I have to shoot within this window, what I look for is overhangs. And this is a huge, huge tip. Overhangs. And what an overhang is, if you have a garage, and I'm going to draw it this way, like this is me, the photographer, standing with my camera, and this is my subject down here. He's inside a garage, and the garage has an overhang, and the overhang stops the downlight from raccoon-izing this person and only lets the light that's coming in here and the light that's bouncing off the ground back at them. So a garage, under a tree, like you're looking to put someone just underneath something. And that, again, that's what I do often when I'm shooting in not the perfect time, but the light is good. And I'm going to try to find an example as to where I, when I put someone in an overhang. Ah, here it is. So this is a situation where I put my model underneath so the top down light wasn't affecting him, and he was getting the bounce up and the direction sideways. He's getting this light now. He's not getting the effect of the top down because he's on a step in an underhang. And now the overcast light, you can see I have details in the highlights. I have details in the shadow. You can see this arm is lit. You can see back here is shadow. And you can see his lit side and the shadow side of his face and how gradual that transition is between one side of his face and the other. So that's because it's a non-optimal time, but I put him under an overhang, so I'm able to get photography without the light, the bad time of day affecting him. So again, overhangs are super, super key and a great, great, great trick. What's another example? So there's also fabrics. You saw a great example of a photographer who was using the model's shirt, like she was using that to kind of scrim herself. There's fabrics that you can use. There's blockers. Another secret way to use a reflector that many photographers don't know is not as a reflector, but you use it as a blocker. And I'm going to show exactly what I mean. Imagine you are shooting. And again, I draw the best stick figures, so I hope you guys are into it. So this is you shooting with your camera, and your subject is here, posing, looking like a badass, and you're trying to catch this, but the sun is up here and it's kicking down crazy top light. Your assistant can hold the reflector, and I've seen so many people hold the reflector down here, and what that does is it bounces up so much that whether the sun is here, which is we're using the example, it bounces back up so much that it almost gives them that like flashlight under the face kind of look, like it's almost too much bounce. And a reflector, you need it to be the silver side in order to counter how dark those shadows are. So the model's not going to be able to open their eyes. They're going to be blinded. If you've ever seen the silver side of a reflector bounced into your face from the sun, it's blinding. So what you need to do is, rather than use this as a reflector, you use it as a blocker. So you have the subject, or you have an assistant, which is your guy over here, hold the reflector up here. So he's now off frame and he's holding the reflector above. And now the sun that's coming here, you're essentially creating a little shadow area for that person to stand in, which blocks the light that's coming down. And then you get your meter reading in here and you're able to shoot in here, obviously crop out your guy and get natural light diffused in the way that in the spot that you want. Doing this as a solution, we're doing this less because it's like you're trying to fix a solution because you're locked to the location. You can also find a better location and or a better time of day, so you're not dealing with this top-down light, but this is one way to completely fix it. You can use foam core, you can use negative fill, and a reflector has some transparency. So a reflector, some of the light actually passes through. So I use a reflector because it allows some of the ambient to push through. So again, that's a couple of different ways that you can use a reflector, couple of different ways to use natural light, a couple of different ways to like see natural light, when to go out. Obviously, first 2 hours after sunrise, last 2 hours before the sun dips, put yourself in a new scenario. Go outside. If you guys are wallflowers, if you're hanging inside, if you haven't gone on a photo walk, if you haven't gone out and asked to take pictures of some strangers, do that exercise. I don't think that there's a better exercise than street portraits of strangers for a new photographer. It will help you so much. It gives you so much confidence because you have to get over asking a stranger for a photo and then shooting through the photo and nailing an amazing photo, and a photo that's great enough to show that person and they're like, whoa, that's amazing. And then share your social media, get the person's information, and then email the photo to them. Like, that's what you have to do when you do street portraits, but it makes all of us better. Those people who we shoot portraits of share that stuff on social media. They tag us. More people follow our account. More people ask us, hey, can you take my photo? Like, going out and shooting street portraits, it puts you on the wheel. Like the way that I describe photographers who aren't working, they're like in a cage. There's a hamster wheel there and there's other hamsters that are running. And the wheel is, and the photographers that aren't working are just standing there and they're watching it. And it's like, how you have to like do things that put you on the wheel. They're usually hard. Shooting strangers is hard. Doing a self-directed project for yourself with nobody checking in on you, with nobody really caring whether you do it or not, like that stuff is hard. A self-directed project will put you on the wheel. doing street portraits and going out once a week and doing it week after week after week, this is going to put you on the wheel. You're going to meet someone. He's a magazine editor. And he's like, hey, show me your photographs. Like, something's going to happen if you continually go out with your camera and try to take pictures of new people. It's something that it's hard. But if you're trying to be a professional photographer, you have to put yourself in shitty scenarios and shoot your way out of it. Because that's what we do. Clients put us in shitty scenarios, and we have to photograph our way out of it. So if you're not doing that for yourself, if you're not giving yourself assignments, if you're not giving yourself challenges, things that put you out of your comfort zone, once you're now trying to get hired by clients, why would a client take a risk on you? Why is a client going to pay you when you're not even taking risks on your own, when there's no money at stake? You know, take risks on your own. Go out, do something radical. That's how we make a mark with our photography, and that's how we get on the wheel. There's nothing worse than being on the outside looking in. But, you know, photographers who are working, it doesn't seem like they're on the wheel. They're just working. They're just doing what they do. You know, you see me, I'm working, you know, I'm happy, I'm working, because I'm able to make people happy with my photographs, which is the only reason that I'm here, is to like spread joy and be of service to people through my creativity, you know. So if no one's hiring you, or if no one's paying you right now for your creativity, you have to give yourself the assignments. You have to create your own assignments. You have to execute them on your own. And that's the work that will get you work, I promise you. But you guys really got to put it out there. This is the year. It's almost spring, guys. We're like a week away from the first day of spring, which means we made it through the winter, which means we made it through the hardest time, and we're about to roll into the easiest time. But I want you guys to try hard this year, because I just lectured to like 40 students, and these students are trying to take your food. They want to know everything about how to succeed at photography. They asked me great questions, and they're hungry. You know, you guys have a bit of an advantage because you guys get this information every day in a different way. And I got to tell you, photography school is not the same as this type of learning. It's not the same. Photography school is just different. So I'm trying to bring you the best parts of photography school, and I'm adding a whole bunch of stuff that photography school doesn't teach you. So I hope you guys like my content. So if there's any questions about approach, my approach, approaches that you guys should try, please ask. Know that you can leave questions in the comments of this video as you're watching it. I answer every single comment. I read every single comment. So I know that four times as many people watch this podcast after the fact as watch it live. So leave a comment. I read them all. If you have questions, leave them in the comments. I answer them all. And you can still join my Discord. You can still submit photographs, and you can still have your photographs reviewed. And you can do all that not live. Like, it's easy to do. Just join the Discord. So speaking of the Discord, now I'm going to jump into the Discord and do some real photo reviews. But do tell me if you guys have any questions. If you have any questions about any of the stuff that I've been talking about today, any questions about light, any questions about nervousness, how I battle nervousness when it comes to shooting street portraits, just ask me. I'm an open book, and I have lots of insight as far as how I battle going out and talking to strangers and asking them for photos. So ask me if you have any questions. All right, let's get into some real photo reviews. We got some photos from Julie. We got a couple photos from Turtle. Let's go. Guys, you have literally probably 5 whole minutes if you want to submit photos. It's going to take me probably 20 minutes to do these photo reviews, and then we're going to wrap it up. Let's get into some photographs from Julie Legovska. Julie is a Ukrainian-born photographer. She lives here in Toronto now, but she recently went back to the Ukraine. Don't ask me why, because there's a goddamn war there. But Julie is my one of my assistants, has become one of my assistants through all the help and work that she does for my podcast. She's also in Toronto, so it helps as well. Julie, I'm feeling this. I'm feeling this, and it's a really great demonstration of everything that I'm talking about today, and it's a perfect natural light portrait to speak about overcast, because this is an overcast day, and you can see the nuance between the shadow and the highlight, this being the highlight and down here being the shadow, the nuance that's happening in here. It's very, very slight. And the nose triangle. So you can see the light is relatively top down, but you made it work so beautifully. Her having this fur kind of hiding her face, her looking off camera is really great. Her head angle is strong. Her hair looks good. Everything is great about this photo, Julie. Her hand is in the frame, but looks natural. It doesn't look like a claw. You know that we've seen many hands in the frame that look claw-like, but this is not one of them. This is a great shot. This is a great shot. I've given it 11. Look at it as a cover. Look at it as a cover. It's strong. Yes or yes? Right? It's a great shot, Julie. You should be thrilled. Thrilled.
Let's go.
All right. Let's look at another from Julie. The smile is great. It's a second alternative picture to this one. If you guys just look, this, you can see how important the head angle, and with the head angle up, how much it brightens up here. Under here is really, really great. And it just makes her look brighter. Again, how she's holding her jacket is nice. The fur up around her neck is really nice. Like, it shapes and molds her face. The little sweep here is really good. It's a great shot, Julie. I'm trying to figure out which one I like better. This is kind of mysterious. This is kind of fun. I'm way more into this pose. I'm way more into this head angle. You know, her chin is up just enough in this photo. But this is all the mystery. I love this. I think this is my favorite. I think this one is your best photo. Julie, you did a great job. This is epic. Both of them are great. And you can just see the slightest nuance of the head up and how much brighter it makes underneath her eyes. Like, it's so slight, but the difference. Yeah. Great job, Julie. First two photos from Miss Legovska. All right, Julie. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. All right. Turtle. Some more shots from San Ramon. San Ramon on 3/5. So that means March 5th. San Ramon. This is drone photography from Turtle. Turtle, these streets, I really want to see you sky high. I want to see you sky that drone and give me top down, because these graphic streets and these buildings and the colors, it's like white, 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 like white. I feel like how graphic white, 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 like just a top down. And like those super graphic map style shots where it's like I see this being shot that way. The angle that you're hitting, again, it's not as powerful, I think. And it has to do with the diagonals, like this line and how the lines converge out. For me, that's a little tricky for my eyes to reconcile. I feel like You're also now getting an area up here where you're not getting a lot of information. You're also getting an area down here. It's kind of the same way. I feel like if you skied this drone and squared it off and delivered us some of the disciplined photographs that you've done with some of your other drone photography, I think that I'd be happier with this particular image. I know what you're capable of. I know what your level is. I just want you to like hit it every time. And it's like, it's not easy to hit it every time. Like this is an example. Like I look at this photograph of yours, Turtle, and the discipline in which you captured this photograph. And this is the discipline that I'm asking for with this photo. Cause I know you have it in you. Like the lines, look at the distance between here, here, and here. Like this distance is exactly the same. It's the same here. Like he's like all of these lines are so straight, got beautiful sun flare here, and just the angle of these solar panels as you go up and how the angles change almost make it like a gradient. Like it looks, this is a really, really cool photo, Turtle. I like this a lot. I'm looking at them out of order, but I want this to become a style. I think that's the thing that I keep looping back to. I want this to become a style. I feel like, hey, Bear Thunder, good evening, sir. I feel like this is a style that I want to see more of. These for me are in between pictures. In between pictures, I feel like they're going to start falling from your portfolio and they're going to be starting to be replaced with more of these like highly almost methodical photos. Just my two cents. All right, let's look at more. This is closer. I'm not sure if this is a reshot. If you reshot this photo or if it's a cropped version of another like subdivision that you shot before, but this is closer. It's closer to the angle. I gave you some great ideas as to what to do in here. I would still like this a little higher, although I don't mind this angle. I would love to see more of this road and more of this road. I think these curves are super interesting. This one here as well. So I would like to see what that road does a little bit more. So this particular one, I'd like to see you skied just a touch. And I know I said I wanted you to punch in. I asked you to punch in and give me like just like this subdivision, and you have, but I think again, I want it a little bit more squared off, but I like where this is going. I like where you're going there. I feel like there's a little bit more development that has to happen, but you're definitely on the right track. Definitely. This is very interesting now. You see, you're fucking with me. See, now I'm not supposed to like this angle. I'm not supposed to like this angle, but you nailed it. Like, I'm not supposed to like this angle, but this is everything. This is everything. And also the selective color, I don't know if you're noticing, but this photograph only has like four colors. You know what I mean? He's taken color out. There's no color in the road. There's no color in several of the trees. So this photograph is made up literally of like four colors. So it's called selective desaturation, which is a technique that I showed Turtle, which he's adopting. I'm really liking this for fine art. I wouldn't mind seeing a little bit more color coming back in here, but I'm actually really about it. This is one of my favorites for the day. The fact that you can follow the road, take the turn and go all the way back down here is what makes this photograph so interesting for me. This is fantastic, Turtle. Fantastic. And again, this is I think it might be my favorite from you for the day, buddy. It might be my favorite from you, and I think it beats that one. I hate to say it, Turtle, but this is your best of the day so far, my guy. I'm in love with this flick. Unless this one beats it. Fuck. This one might beat it, Turtle. This one might beat it, my guy. This is everything. This is it. This is what I'm asking for. This almost looks like a puzzle of some sort. It looks like a painting. Look at the leading line here. How your eye comes in and goes around. Like, there's just more. Like, I wonder if you could do a multiple shot image so you can get this resolution times several neighborhoods. Because I'm really interested, like, where these streets go. You know, I know that's a roundabout, so I would like to see more of that roundabout and this roundabout that's coming around here. But oh my God, this is another banger. And now my second favorite photo from your set. My second favorite. This is absolutely nuts. Turtle. Wow. Good job, buddy. Look at Turtle actually killing it. Let's go, my guy.
Let's go.
So, Turtle, if I had to say favorite number two is right there. Where's my mouse? Oops. Favorite number two is there. Favorite number one is right here. This is your photo of the day. I'm floored. So good. So good. So good. All right, that is some new flickas from the one they call Josh McCoy. They also call him Turtle, but I try to call him Josh. And then Alice says, some of my favorites. I love how you spelled favorites. Of my uncle fishing. I never shared from our camping trip in October. This is a great capture, Alice. Really great capture and a great shot to submit for today. Look at the use of shooting into the sun. The sun's up here, right? Just offset. You can see the long lines. Sun travels in straight lines, so you know the sun is over here pushing in this way. We have a beautiful silhouette on your uncle, which looks amazing. A really nice haze that's happening here. And these long shadows are everything. Really nice coastline, really busy water. And this hill up here is really great. You could try in this photo lowering yourself. So if you push down and like sat your bum on this super wet sand, what that's going to do, it's going to take this horizon line, which is going through him, and it's going to drop it so that horizon line now goes here. Then now what happens is you have him standing and his body pushes up, like, so it's almost like he's kind of more mountainous than the background, and you're not fighting with his position and the position of the horizon line in the background because you've lowered it. I'd love to see the horizon line go through him about there. Now it's making a hero photo, which is something that I want you guys to all be thinking about, how to make hero photos. And that's all about like lofting and isolating. We're trying to loft our subject and isolate. So in this situation, how you would loft is lower your perspective, and how you're isolating him, you're doing it. You have him on this big open sky. It's just push him up. So he's what you see against that sky. Right now, we're just seeing a little bit of him. And then that's going to make this fishing rod even more predominant. If this is a boat, I would push that boat so it's a little bit more predominant in frame. Or like move him down this way a little bit. Move yourself down this way, and then this will be out of the frame altogether. But Alice, this is banging. This is banging. You should be very happy with this photo.
Let's go.
should be very happy with this photo. Come on now. And I think you submitted one more. Wow. And again, this is what I asked for. I asked her to go down, which now look what she's done. She's now pushed the horizon line. You see this, how much stronger it is now that the horizon line is above him and it's not affected. You still have a great silhouette, but now you've like empowered him because his only background is the water. So for me, that's great isolation. You're also using scale. Oops, I'm drawing on the wrong screen. You've isolated him obviously because here, just exactly what I said when he was up here, but now you've pushed him down this hill, which now brings that horizon line from breaking his shoulders to above his head, which is perfect. For an example, I'm going to zoom in. I'm going to enlarge this and crop right there. Look at that photograph. Because he's not on the horizon line, look at that crop. Look at this as a double page spread, right? Look at the light, look at the line, look at the motion in the water hitting his feet. Look at the texture, look at his little bit of bait down here. All of this is everything, right? But again, it's just because you shot this photograph in such a way that there's elements, like you have quadrants in this photograph. This down here is a quadrant, right? There's an element here that's super strong. This is a quadrant, and this element over here is super strong. Now, we have super big sky, and you have two big blocks that aren't very important. So for me personally, in this shot, I would have gone closer. I would have cut the sky out completely, and I would have delivered the photograph exactly how I just gave it to you, which is essentially that as the crop. But it's hard when you're on the fly and when you're in it, seeing that and rushing in to catch that punched in crop, but amazing. Yeah, it really, really amazing. Really amazing. Should be happy with this session. And then there's one more. And Bear has some new sand. The light here is amazing. And I'm very curious as to what the other shots would look like in this light, but with the same exposure. This is really pretty. Really pretty. This is a frameable photograph. You should think about making framing this. This is a photo that someone would put on their wall. This is something that someone would put above their bed, in their bedroom, in the hallway, above their couch. Just someone who loves the ocean, who misses it. Like, this is a frameable picture. Print this, Alice. Print this, please. This is fantastic. Fantastic. Amazing. Amazing, 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 amazing. All right. I have another viewer. His name is The Mighty Bear Thunder. That's actually how you have to say it. The Mighty Bear Thunder. Bear has been working on a technique for shooting macro for over 2.5 years. Now, I'm not talking like bugs. I'm talking grains of sand. Okay, grains of sand. And what Bear Thunder has been doing is he's been photographing grains of sand from beaches all around the world, and also documenting how the sand structure is different, the color is different. He's also telling us where the sand is from. Like, it's pretty incredible. This self-directed project, which again, Bear started this project on his own. He thought of it on his own. He's built much of the equipment that he's using to create these photographs on his own. And at this point, where he's now over 2 years in, he is now shooting this in such a way that, well, you'll see, it looks like it's like museum documentation. Like, he's museum level documenting grains of sand. And I'm going to show you this scale. Look at this. And how incredible is this as an idea? And he shows us, Bear is from Norway, and he's showing us a millimeter. And you can see that these grains of sand are smaller than a millimeter. This is impressive is an understatement. The amount of effort, and not to mention he puts them in this crazy arrangement and then photographs them with like an electron microscope. I'm very, very proud of you, Bear. This is incredible work. So that's one from Bear. Again, my viewers. And the funny thing is, the thing that makes me so proud is Bear developed this technique through the time that he was watching this show. Bear's been watching me for almost as long as I've been doing this podcast. So like the level of work and how he's progressed, it's actually mind-blowing. Bear, this is stupid, dude. This is dumb. Like, just dumb. Look at this. Oh my God. This is so good looking. Look at this. How absolutely insane is this photography? And again, this is the people who watch my show. This is the mighty Bear Thunder. And again, showing you that this is from Emerald Creek in Idaho in the US. And look at how pretty this sand is. So beautiful. So great, eh? Like, right? It just makes me smile. Every time I see these, I'm like, Barrett, this is going to be in a museum. I'm telling you. I think he needs to do a coffee table book of this project. And like, yeah, right? Holy crazy. It gives me joy. You know, Alice's self-portraits, they give me joy. Bear's sand gives me joy. You know, Warbucks self-portraits gives me joy. You guys, whenever you submit your photographs, man, it gives me joy. Julie's portraits, Hell Dog's wildlife photography, you know, Casper's car photography, it all just gives me joy. I think about you guys when I'm not streaming, you know, I think about you guys. And this is the last one. This is from the Dead Sea in Israel. Look at this. Dead Sea sand. Dead Sea sand. Say that three times fast. Dead Sea sand. Look at this photography. I don't know. If you're wondering how he does this, I don't know, by the way. You have to ask Bear. I've seen a couple of BTS shots, but the real nuance, the ins and outs as to how this guy does this. Yeah, and Bear, they should be for sale immediately. Sand and salt. So great. Salt and sand. So, so, so clever. I mean, oftentimes after people, and I have to say this, after I look at photographs that are that strong, if you're watching and you're intimidated about submitting photographs, please don't be intimidated. Chat, please tell. Yo, Hell Dog, let's go. Let's go. Where have you been, my guy? You know, it's another guy that I've been thinking about, Hell Dog, and saying, you know, I know this guy's working hard. I know he's working hard. I know it because Hell Dog only goes MIA when he's really working hard. And I know that that's what he's doing right now. But also, I want you to know, Hell Dog, that I'm like, I'm in your pocket, bro. I'm always thinking about you guys. Always. I want you guys to know that. I do think about you. I think about your work. I think about when you're not submitting, what's happening when you're not shooting or when you're not watching. I'm always just wondering what you guys are up to, you know? Your success is really important to me. You guys being, I know, Hell Dog, and I feel that. But know that you have such a great support system here and people who can help fuel you and give you ideas. So you can also always DM me offline. You can always talk to me offline. If you have anything that you want to talk about or any questions or stresses, or if you just want to talk, you can talk to me anytime, Hell Dog. You know that, my guy. We've had these talks before, and it's usually around this time of the year. So let's talk. Happy to help. And also, yeah, know that it's also in the universe. It's not just you that's having this feeling right now. It's in the universe. We are all having this feeling right now. And you're not alone. You're not alone. Know that you're not alone, Jesper. And reach out. It helps more than you know. I'm telling you. Because there's days that, believe me, dude, I am like not feeling like talking. Not feeling like talking, not motivated, but yet I'm here and I'm motivating, you know, I'm here and I'm motivating sometimes even when I don't know what the fuck am I going to talk about today, you know, but it always comes together. And after my shows, I always feel like so full. I always feel so full up and satisfied. And yeah, I hope you guys feel it. And it, again, it's like you guys help me as much as I help you. So it's mutual. By the way, guys, if you haven't noticed, I now have timestamps on all my past episodes. So if you haven't watched a podcast in a while, if you haven't watched a past episode in a while, know that if you go to last week's episode or Sunday's episode or any of the episodes that you might have missed, including the marketing episode, which was super, super helpful. If you go to any of my episodes, you can see here now that it says on the bottom, it says all the different chapters and what I'm talking about and exactly where it is. So although I encourage you guys to watch the episodes, if you're looking for your photo review, now it's like, now your photo reviews, and it'll say Bear Thunder review, Vicky review, Julie review, Warbucks review. So everything now, that's what it's going to be like going forward. And Turtle, special thanks to Turtle. Turtle is helping me do this with back episodes. I'm doing them for every episode that are going forward. And yeah, Turtle's helping me do it with older past episodes. So it's actually really great when you look at an episode like this and you expand and you go down here and you see this. You see chapters and you say view all, and you can come over here and then just see everything that I'm talking about and just click there and it snaps you right to it. So this is more things that I'm adding. I'm always trying to make this whole stream better, this whole channel better, this whole experience better for you. And also I'm trying to make it better and easier for you to find the information that I talk about during every one of my podcasts. So chapters for you. It's a lot of work, by the way. It takes time. It takes time, but I'm doing them. So I hope you guys are watching my content. By the way, I'm very close to monetizing. Very, 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 very close. I'm going to show you how close that I am. And just before we wrap up here today, I'm going to give you guys a couple of things that you can do in order to help me. If you're interested in helping me get to that spot where I'm monetized, the number one thing that you can do to help is watch my videos till the end. Watch my videos and watch them to the end. And if you don't finish them, come back later and finish it. It helps me if you get it to the end. But I haven't shown you guys this in a while, but have a look at this watch time. I'm almost at 3,000 hours. The last time I showed you guys this, I was at like less than 2,000 hours. Look at this. Look at my subscribers. Again, like I'm way past 1,000. And I've also, I mean, you need 10 million shorts views to monetize that way. I'm obviously going to monetize here faster than this because 27,000 shorts views doesn't even give me anything. So this is how close we are. Now, how you can help me is by watching my videos to the end. You know, that's the biggest thing because that pushes them out to more people. But if you look at my analytics, look, everything is up. Everything is up. My views, 10,000 more views than normal. Watch time, I'm getting like almost 500 hours of watch time per month. If I need 1,300 hours, I need 2 months and a bit to get there. And again, 78 subscribers in the last 28 days. Like this channel, and it's your help that is helping me blow this up. So if you want to help, the quickest way to do it is if you have unlimited internet. Don't do this if you don't have unlimited internet at your house. But if you have unlimited internet, go to my channel, go to one of my playlists, and literally just click play all. That's it. It's simple. Push play all, and it will just play my video one after the other after the other. You want that to go on for a while? Click Ask a Photo Pro Season. Look at how many episodes are here. It's just going to play that 2 hours, then that hour, then that. Like, if you want to help, that will help me get to. And again, you can mute me, you can close it. Like, that helps more than you know. I want real valuable viewers, just like I want to give you real valuable content. I wouldn't ask you to just be playing my stuff if you haven't watched it already and got that knowledge out of there. But many of you guys can't afford to donate. It's like times are tough. And believe me, when I was on Twitch, just to give you a perspective, when I was on Twitch, I had around like 80, 90 subs. I was like making money every month. I'm on Twitch. That I told everybody to stop subscribing to my Twitch because I'm bringing it to YouTube for free. But for the people who were subscribed, the 80 or 90 people who were subscribed, if they could just maybe donate once a month, that $5 that they were giving to Twitch already, now they don't have to give it, it's free. Hey, maybe donate if you feel like it, because that, you know, the percentage of people who have is not high. I mean, Alice and some others are like Oki and 44 Games and Jason, like some people definitely support that way and it definitely helps. But the whole goal is like, I'm not trying. If I missed you for donating, I apologize. You guys, everybody who's donated, I appreciate that. Know that I'm not doing these podcasts to make money from the people who I'm teaching. I'm doing this in order to create like a long-term ongoing legacy of photography content that eventually will be monetized and eventually will make money. So I'm not stressing about it now, especially from my earliest subscribers. Like, you guys are my core. The people who watch my podcast now, tell me I won't stop a bullet for you guys. I'm telling you, because you guys believed in me and took my instruction and my help when I had like really no reputation for this format. You believed in and believed in the work that I do offline, obviously. And we've really turned this into something. And it's gonna get better. I now have access to a studio more often. So the studio sessions and the studio behind the picture episodes are gonna start happening more and more. And the more those studio sessions happen, I'm gonna get better at teaching light while I'm shooting. I find it very hard. And I realized this last time I was in the studio on the weekend, on Friday, I find it hard to teach light while I'm shooting. Cause I just want to shoot. I don't want to like, I want to shoot. It's all hype, but stopping and like explaining, I found it hard. So what I did is, I used Julie as, I'm sorry. What happened, Hell Dog? What happened? Is it you're sending me skin or you're sending me photos that are too big? But again, I have to wrap up because I have a couple of things that I have to do. But Hell Dog, you will figure out how to, you will sort submitting the photos and I will look at them Thursday. You know, and if you want to message me in between now and Thursday, we can have a little talk offline and then I'll look at them Thursday because I want to have a clear headspace. Believe me, last night I couldn't sleep. I was up until like 6 a.m. and then I woke up at 8 a.m. and I went and lectured for 2 hours and then I rushed back and now I'm talking to you guys for another 2 hours. So I need to like do some work and then shut down a little bit. And I'm back on again tonight. But yeah, Hell Dog, don't worry. You'll figure it out. You're probably trying to use your phone or something. I don't know what the issue is, but I know that you'll sort it. Guys, if you have any last questions, please consider asking them now or shelve them for Thursday. Helly, I'm glad you're here. I hope you've been feeling my psychic energy. I've been sending you good juju for the last little while. I hope you're feeling it. Yeah, guys, if you're not subscribed already, please consider hitting the subscribe button. It is free to subscribe here on YouTube. So why not do it? It's free. You get notified every time I go live, every time I upload new content. And the Discord is how this whole community is growing, how all my fans and my friends and my people, my viewers in chat know each other and all back and forth with the banter. That all comes from this community that we're building on Discord. I want you to be a part of it. So join the Discord. The link for the Discord is in the description of the video that you're watching. And I think that's about it. If you guys like me, you like my smiling face, you can watch me play Warzone badly, which is always entertaining. I do that Tuesday, Thursday, and Sunday, which are the same days that I podcast. So please consider coming and hanging out with us on Twitch this evening. Oh fuck, I gotta sneeze. One sec.
Treat everybody like a superstar. Famous.
That's the wrong video.
Less like a superstar.
That's the wrong video. Photographer. Look how you're dressed. Yes, you. You just wear track pants, t-shirt. If you're gonna wear track pants and a t-shirt, at least look fly like me. Here, take this. Right? How fly do you look now? You guys wanna get the flyest apparel for creatives and photographers, you gotta tune into that merch store. There it is. Look at, I have over 100 items spread between 2 merch stores, limited edition drops. Every video that you watch on YouTube, as well as on all my channel pages, you'll see the links for my merch store. Make sure that you guys jump in there and look fly like I do when you're shooting. Let's get it on. Oh boy. The merch is still flying. And know that every time someone sees me wearing this stuff, they're like, dude, where'd you get that? It's like, it's my collection. It's my collection. I make merchandise. That's another thing that I do. One of the many hustles. Guys, if you like this type of content, hit the like. I'm trying to get at least 10 likes on this video. The more likes, the more engagement, the more chat messages, the more comments. Leave a comment if you've made it to the end of this video And tell me this. What is your favorite type of natural light to shoot? Is it front light? Is it side light? Is it backlight? Or do you like overcast or open shade? If you've made it to this far in the video, tell me what your favorite type of natural light is in the comments. I'll be back tonight for some Warzone. I'll be back here on Thursday for another banger of a show. I'm going to turn into a pumpkin. I have a new end screen. You gotta stay and watch my end screen. I love you guys. I appreciate you all. Thank you guys so much for watching today and every day. Don't forget to play a playlist. Appreciate you guys.